My name is John Enamite. I have the privilege of leading this college. I appreciate you guys being here. It really means a lot to have this participation. You look around, you say, well, the auditorium's only about half full. This is the first time the college has hosted an event such as this, specific to entrepreneurship and small business development. So I think the turnout is positive. What I want you to do when you get finished with today, after you walk away saying, wow, this was such good information, spread the word, because small business development, entrepreneurship is one of those $10 words that everybody says, what exactly does that mean? It's all about starting small business and developing small businesses. It's critical to our economy, especially in a rural area such as Stanley County. We need small businesses, and we don't have enough of them. Company or counties are waiting for large businesses to come in with 1,000 jobs to give everybody jobs. Those days are few and far between. What we need are people who want to start their own businesses and cultivate something they grow themselves. So that's what you're going to hear more about today. We've got some great speakers, but first I want to thank Alicia Heron and Mike for putting this event on. Without their leadership, you wouldn't be here this morning. You'd be in class wondering, when is today going to be over? So appreciate them. Appreciate our speakers. Lamont, I appreciate you driving over this morning. I know a long, tiring drive, but I appreciate that. You guys are going to hear from a variety of people who are going to give you different insights. I know we've got quite a few cosmetology students in here. That's one thing I'm challenging this college to do, is look at our technical programs, cosmetology, collision repair, these technical programs, because when you guys graduate from cosmetology, for example, you have great skills in how to be a cosmetologist. But what we're not preparing you to do is how to run a small business. So yeah, you could go rent a booth, but we haven't truly prepared you on how to be successful if you wanted to start your own salon or just hang out your own shingle, as they say. So I'm challenging our group to help prepare our technical students for just that, so that you are prepared when you walk out of here to start your own business, so that you don't have to work for someone else, so that you understand what it means when somebody comes in and you perform a service and they hand you cash. You don't just stick it in your pocket and forget about it. You understand what your obligations are as a small business owner, so that you can plan and be successful in the long term. Because that's a trap that a lot of students who are graduating from technical programs fall into. They don't understand what it means to start a small business. What you're going to hear about today from our guest speakers is what it means to be a small business owner. You're going to hear about leadership. You're going to hear about small business development. It's going to be a really exciting day. These guys are much better speakers than I. So pay close attention. What we want to do is really pique your interest. Today is not the end of our message about entrepreneurship. Today is just the beginning. So I strongly encourage you to listen to what you hear today, and ask questions. We have a number of services available to our students and our community here at the college. Not just our technical programs, not just the programs that you're in, curriculum. We have continuing ed classes. We have a small business center right here in Albemarle. We can do almost anything that we can to help you. If we can't help you, we're going to find resources that will be able to help you. So I challenge you to not let today be the last time you think about entrepreneurship or starting your own small business. I challenge you to think about it more and start your own business as you finish your program of study. Again, welcome this morning. It's the first time we've had this. So at the end of the day, if you think of any things that we can do to make this event even better, feel free to let us know. Bless you. Because we want to continue to do this. We want this event to grow, to become more of a community event, because we are a community college. So spread the word. Let us know how we can make things better. But most of all, have a great day and take something away from it. Learn at least one thing. Okay? Thank you very much. Have a great day.
So good morning, everyone. Did most of you at least get a little bit of coffee? I hope. Yes. Good. I know I had one individual crying as she had to throw hers away because she couldn't bring it into the auditorium. I've shed that tear many times entering the auditorium, not being able to bring in my coffee. So again, we're really glad to have each and every one of you here this morning. Thank you for participating. And I want to thank the program heads that told their students, hey, we're going to go today. So some of you may not have initially planned on entrepreneurship or an event about entrepreneurship being something that you wanted to consider. But, you know, quite honestly, whenever I was younger, I say I'm now in my old age. Some people give me a hard time about that because I'm still fairly young. But, you know, whenever I was growing up, entrepreneurship really wasn't discussed much. It was, hey, you need to go get a job for somebody that can give you benefits, that can, you know, you can just retire there. Things are changing. And Dr. Enemite really, in his opening comments, hit the nail on the head in saying, we need more small business. If you look at our economy, or if you're just driving down the road, small business is more than just the McDonald's, the franchises that we see, but that's still a part of it. I don't know if you've ever noticed, you know, the small mom and pop shops, or even some of the larger retailers that maybe started at a smaller level. I'm reading this week about how Starbucks started in just like a little market, right? Where they were just selling coffee beans. Well, now it's just this, it's a worldwide enterprise that started as a very small business. So when you hear about entrepreneurship, please don't be closed-minded or don't be intimidated by the word. Because like Dr. Enemite said in his explanation, some people may not know what it is, but like he said, it's small business development. But I also want to encourage you to be entrepreneurial. And think about that throughout this session as well. So entrepreneurship is whenever you're entrepreneurial within an organization. So even if your initial plans in leaving college is not to start your small business right out of the gate, still consider being entrepreneurial within whatever endeavor or whatever venture, whatever enterprise you work within, because you still have that potential to later work for yourself, right? So what I'm saying here, let me summarize it. Please do not leave today thinking, oh, you know, I'm not going to start a business today. I'm not going to do it tomorrow. Please be open-minded. Please keep an entrepreneurial spirit, and you're going to learn all about that today. But very quickly, I want to tell you a little bit about a resource that we have on campus that can help you with that. So it's our Small Business Center, and I have the pleasure of being the director of our Small Business Center. We are in downtown Albemarle. How many of you knew that the college had a Small Business Center? What? Nice. Good. I bet if I would have asked that question a year ago or 2 years ago, I would have had maybe just one or two hands. So the word's getting out. I hope that you're going to tell people whenever you leave today. But what is the Small Business Center? Because even though some of you may have heard of it, you may not know quite what we do. So at the Small Business Center, we offer first free resources. And those are resources for you to explore, you know, hey, I want to do this, I want to do that. We assist you by free confidential counseling that's one-on-one, also free seminars. And again, linking you with service providers to maybe compensate. Like Dr. Enemite said, if we don't have the resources, we will find them for you. So please consider the Small Business Center as an ally in helping you explore, hey, I have this idea. I want to start this venture. Can I do it? Right? So we're going to be an advocate for you. We're going to help you make sure that the foundation is really built and that you can walk into a venture confident in starting your small business. So we are here as a resource. You will receive a goodie bag when you leave today, and my information is in there. So if you want to partner with the Small Business Center, please give me a call. But I want to go ahead and move forward to our next portion of the morning, and that would be with Mr. Mike Sperling, giving you more of an overview of what entrepreneurship really is.
Okay, Dr. Enemite talked about entrepreneurship, and many of you, well, the college students, I imagine, auto body and so forth, perhaps you are thinking about one day starting and running your own business, but perhaps you're not. That's okay. The entrepreneurial mindset can be used in every aspect of life. It's a can-do mindset. It's something I urge you all to adopt and to embrace. Now, there's many facets of entrepreneurial mindset, but what I want to talk about today is choice, opportunity, action, community, and persistence. That's five of the most important parts of entrepreneurship, or that can do, that growth mindset that we all should strive to achieve. Let me talk to you about our economy today before I start on this. You all know, you all understand that the economy is in a flux, right? Those jobs that many people in Stanley County at one time depended on are gone. Contrary to beliefs that we're going to bring those jobs back, I'm not so sure. Don't want to break your bubble. Technology's replaced a lot of those jobs, right? So people are no longer required where technology has taken over. But that doesn't mean that you give up and that you accept a life of want. That just means that you have to prepare yourself and take as many skills as you can into the world with you. And the entrepreneur mindset is a toolbox that you should continue to supply with new knowledge and new tools. Choice. This is something that separates us from most other animals. So we have choice. It's very powerful. We can make choices. We just don't think about where our next meal's coming from. Well, some of us might. But the entrepreneur mindset will grow beyond that for you. It's assumptions. Let me tell you about assumptions. How many people here think they can be successful? How many people here know they will be successful? All right. How many people here have been told they won't be successful? All right. Our assumptions, our mindset, are based on our life experiences. If you've heard your whole life that you can't do something, and you accept that as the truth, you're not going to be able to do it. All right. So take a look at your assumptions. When you come up with an idea, something that you think I would really like to do, and then mom, dad, boyfriend, girlfriend, wife, whatever, says, you can't do that. That's impossible. Don't let it stop you. Show them why it's not impossible. There's nothing that's impossible, right? The right knowledge, the right set of tools, you can succeed. So these assumptions, and even how we feel about ourselves, forget that word, I'll go on to something else. Even the way we think about ourselves really can limit us. So I used to be good at math. I say used to be. My assumption is now that I'm not good at math, right? Because I had one bad experience. But you can do whatever you want to do. I know I can do math. What is math? A basic set of rules. Follow the rules, you can get through math, right? Just learn the rules. One of the greatest things that you have available to you is education. You're all being educated now. Our cause students here, our auto body students, our welding students are being educated to take something and create something beautiful out of it, right? These cause students have been asked after me for ages to color my hair. No, it's not going to happen. But I know they could, and I know they could do a good job if I allowed them to do it. It's just not going to happen. So when we're making choices, we do have two choices. We can accept failure, or we can go on the road to success. Accepting failure means not trying and failing. Accepting failure means even before you try, you say, what's the use? It's not going to work. I'm going to fail. Opportunity. This is exciting. Opportunity. Within every problem, this is the entrepreneur mindset. Within every problem, there resides opportunity. Think about that. We're in a world full of problems. You know, that's most of our lives. We think of our problems. Get excited, because within those problems, there is opportunity. There's bigger problems. Amy Ray, our next speaker, we'll talk about responsible entrepreneurship. Is that correct? Right? There is opportunity. In problems, there's opportunity. The social entrepreneurship, taking social problems, turning it into opportunity, and doing good things with your life. with the mindsets, with the right mindset, problems don't stop you. They do inspire you. They energize you. We see a problem here at the college, and some of us get really excited. Not by the fact that we might, it's a problem. It's a fact because we know within that problem, there's room for growth and there's room for opportunity and there's room for success, right? Solutions to problems are a currency of an entrepreneur's mindset. It's your money. Entrepreneurs, and again, this could be intrapreneurs, people who work for an organization, they think growth. They think solving problems. If you go into any organization and you're able to share that mindset, if you're able to go in there with a ability to look at a problem, to work through the problem, the research, and come up with a solution, well, you're going to do a lot better than a lot of other people who just want to drift around with the problems, right? You ever see a sand dollar? Right? They just drift with the flow, drift the flow. Eventually, they end up on the beach, wash up on the shore, and we let them turn white, and we bleach them and kill them and put them on our shelves, right? You don't want to be that. You don't want to be a sand dollar that just goes through life floating with the waves and going wherever the current takes you. You want to be that shark that actually decides, here's where I'm going, right? I got a mission in life. I'm a winner. You know, it occurs to me that as you accept life and you become part of life, you're going to have problems. We all have problems, right? Many of us get up in the morning, myself included, quite often, get up in the morning and first thing I think about is, can't wait to go to bed tonight, right? Just get this day over with. I live for Friday. I live for Saturday, right? And we go through life that way. We're on this treadmill. Just get done. Before you know it, you're up in age. I'm not really up in age. I'm quite young, much younger than I look. But you get up in age, and you say, "My God, what happened?" Right? Get off that treadmill. Start engaging your brain and engage your mind. Start looking for solutions for problems. Exploit those problems. Make money. Make yourself a part of any organization that you know that within that organization or within that small business, if you do start your own small business, that what you do is important and that you are vital to their success. How many people have seen that movie Taken? Right? Liam Neeson goes to those kidnappers of his daughter, "I have a unique skill set and you're not going to want to see it," something to that matter, right? Well, you all have a unique skill set, right? Develop that skill set. Load more knowledge, more tools into your toolbox, and that skill set expands. You're not going to be Liam Neeson. You're not going to go into places and start shooting people. God, I hope not. If we're going that way, talk to me later. I have a counselor who would like to speak to you. But what I'm saying is you're going to go into a business. You're going to go into a job interview, not begging them for a job, but letting them know why they need to hire you. If they don't hire you, they're making a great mistake. You got to adopt that mindset. You're all here gathering great skills, right? I hope you all believe that what you're learning, eventually you will be the best at it, right? I'm sure that when I used to have more hair and stuff, when I got a haircut, I was hoping that the person who's cutting my hair is actually looking at it and thinking, here's what I can do, not just thinking, I'll get by. Use your creativity, use your skills, do the best you can, and you will, again, be successful. Action. How many of us dream? How many people here dream and come up with these great plans in our minds, and nothing ever happens? We all do it. I do it, right? Daydream. You get all excited about something you thought of, and nothing comes of it. Why? Because we don't act on it, right? That old saying, it ain't going to grow if you don't plant the seed, right? I want a tomato plant. Well, that's nice. But for me to have a tomato plant, do I have to do something? I have to at least go buy a tomato plant. Oh, I go to the supermarket and buy tomatoes, right? But if I want to plant a tomato, we call it a tree, a bush, what is it, a plant? That's our agribusiness instructor looking to her for help. I know I have to do something. I might not like doing it. I might not like getting down on my hands and knees and digging a hole in this terrible rocky soil that we seem to have around the state, but I have to do it if I want that tomato plant. Action, action, action changes things. Without action, all your thoughts, all your dreams, all your possibilities are naught. Nothing's gonna happen. Nothing's gonna happen unless you take that first step. To dream and not do anything, it's sad. It's very sad. So you gotta plan, you think, and you put into place an action plan. Now, with action, here's what cripples us, right? The correct mindset sets you free. Wait, this is, did I not change the thing? Why didn't someone tell me I didn't change the thing? Well, thank you for telling me now. Action changes things. That doesn't mean that you plan and wait for the perfect time to start. That's crippling. Oh, God, we all do it. I do it. It's just not the time for that now. Got to wait until everything is just perfect. Guess what? It's never a perfect time. I went to school. Like many of you, I started at a community college. First two times I went into school, guess what? I withdrew from everything. Didn't take me long either. Time wasn't right. Third time, I said, well, the time's never going to be perfect. I got to stick to it. I got to persist, right? And now I'm here in front of you where I never thought I would be. You got to do it. You got to take that first step. I congratulate you all because you all have taken that step. You just didn't dream of becoming cosmetologists or auto body repair. What would I call auto body? Well, whatever, well, I wouldn't want to be Billy's, you know, or welders. We wouldn't be that if we just dreamed about it. You had to take that step to come here and do it. Napoleon Hill, anyone ever hear of Napoleon Hill? That's just how young you all are. Napoleon Hill was one of the original self-help gurus. And what he says here is important. Do not wait, the time will never be right. Start where you stand and work with whatever tools you may have at your command. Start today. Start today, start planning, and start being, start making the ground ready for success. Cultivate the ground for success. By the time you walk out of here today, you're gonna know, and you're gonna understand there's no failure. There might be sometimes where we trip. We have to get back up. But there is success for all of us if we want it, if we act upon our dreams, if we fill up our toolbox with the proper skills and knowledge needed. Community. You know why I go to community? America, this is a cultural study that was done of cultures from all over the world. And America is very much individualist. We are pull ourselves up by the bootstraps type of people, right? Well, guess what? It's impossible to pull yourself up by the bootstraps. As you see in that drawing there, if you were strong enough and you pulled hard enough, you would end up tearing your boots. Right? But you can't defy the law of gravity and pull yourself up. But you can pull yourself up if you ask for help. If Philip came up here and me and a couple other people grabbed onto him, we could pick him up off the ground, right? He can't pick himself up off the ground unless there's something to hang on, right? But you need aid, you need help, you need community. You can't do it on your own. Don't be afraid to ask for help. look for help and be willing to help, right? That's the road to success. Help each other, look for help, look at the community. Well, there's all kinds of resources available for you. Small Business Center, the community college. There's things that you want, some training that you need. Talk to us. We can do continuing ed classes, just about anything you want to learn about. It's possible, and all you have to do is be willing to reach out and ask for help, right? I say surround yourself with empowering people. If you're surrounding yourself with people who tell you there's no chance, there's no opportunity, God, life sucks. Well, guess what? It's gonna drain you, right? Now, I'm not saying if your family's like that, just say goodbye. No, change them. Change, help them to change. Help them to understand the entrepreneurial mindset, the growth mindset. Tell me the company you keep and I'll tell you who you are, right? It's true. We hang around with bad people too much. Sometimes we become bad. We hang around with empowered people and we will become empowered. That was from Miguel del Cervantes. Anyone ever hear Don Quixote? You read it? Great book, right? Great book. A little bit difficult to read. I suggest you read it. Yeah, I know how much you all want to read for fun, but reading is great opportunity to learn and to build that skill set, that toolbox, to put tools in that toolbox that you never thought had existed or were possible. You might not even understand at the time when you're reading it how this will help you out in life. Perhaps most important, persistence. We are all going to fail. We all fail at something. The only way not to fail is really the biggest failure at all, and that's not to do something, not to try, right? We all could sit. We could become hermits and maybe sit in our houses or go get a tent in the woods and just stay there. But we're not getting anything done, not going to be happy, but you're failing because whatever reason you put on this earth for, you're not fulfilling. So persist. We will meet with failures at times, but you have to get up, you have to re-energize yourself, and you have to get back onto that road to success. Always stay on that road to success. The greatest failure is to not even try. Never give up. Calvin Coolidge. Let's see how much people have read history or understand. Can anyone tell me who Calvin Coolidge is or was? He was a president. He was 35th president of the United States. I used to have this saying on my door. I thought it was very interesting and thought-provoking. Nothing in the world can take place of persistence. Talent will not. Genius will not. Education will not. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent, right? That's the most important thing. You persist and you have determination. That sets the environment for success. Never give up. I didn't see Alicia come back, but I see more people coming in. I want to, before I go on to my last final slide, don't worry, I'm almost done. I just wanted to go over some things because I understand I was, and I'm still in school. Yeah, I know, it never ends, right? That's the economy we're in. You always want to be preparing yourself and learning new skills and putting more stuff in that toolbox to keep you ready for the ever quickly changing world that we're living in, right? Now, a lot of us are going to take things that we say, God, why? Right? I'm an accountant. My master's degree is in accounting. I'm not a lot of you saying, God, why? But, you know, when I was in accounting and I was a young student, I couldn't understand why I had to take things like English and math. Even though you think accounting's math, it's very basic math. History. What's that have to do with anything? Right? It teaches you. It gives you those tools in your toolbox. English is so important, especially now, guys. Research, the ability to research and to draw unbiased conclusions is very powerful. It's empowering, right? Don't be that sand dollar that just goes with the drift. When you hear about fake news, instead of just accepting it that it's fake news or accepting that it's real news, do some research and find out what the actual truth is. History. Why is history important? Anyone tell me why history is important? Why do we really care what happened in 1864 or 65 or 1907? History repeats itself, right? Yes. That's right. History doesn't repeat itself. Man does if he doesn't know what he's done in the past. But you can read history, understand history, and you can see the same patterns today as happened in other times in history. Right? There's right ways, and you can see if we do the same thing, we might lead to the same bad circumstances or conclusions that occurred in the past. Now, from the business standpoint, that might be going bankrupt. From a global standpoint, that could mean war, death. So pay attention to those classes, even though you think has nothing to do with my major, not helping me at all, they are. They're giving you that knowledge that you're putting in your toolbox and that you will find ways to take advantage of. Finally, I love this. You ever hear of Henry David Thoreau? Of course not. He was a great thinker. He's one of those guys that if you look him up in Wikipedia or something, he had like 17 different descriptions to describe what he does. I learned this at least by my experiment, that if one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life which he has imagined, he will meet with success unexpected in common hours. Think about that. Follow your dreams. Act upon your dreams. And you have at least a great possibility of being successful. Thank you. Oh, you can clap for me. That's fine. I don't want to cut that off. I want to introduce our next speaker. Our next speaker is a student here at Stanley Community College, someone we're very proud of. A very brilliant student who is going on to, she just rolled her eyes at me, is going on to UNC Charlotte in the fall, and we're going to miss her here, but I'm sure she'll be very successful there. Amy Ray, and Amy's going to talk about some social responsibility. Come on up. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So today in our world, there are all kinds of social issues that exist. Just to name a few, access to clean water, pollution, nutrition, healthcare, and hunger. In regards to these issues, many people view business as the problem instead of the solution to many of these issues. But in truth, entrepreneurs essentially act like a bridge. They can stand in the gap to connect people's needs to the solutions that will meet those needs. And so as a result, many of today's social issues, such as hunger and access to clean water, can be solved by entrepreneurs who step into businesses or even create businesses based off of this idea of solving a problem. An example of this is Bioenergy Conversion Global. Now, they are located in Locust, North Carolina, and they basically recognize the need for renewable energy. And so their solution to step into this gap was to convert trash into energy. Another example is in the Charlotte area. There are areas geographically that are low income that depend heavily on public transportation, and there are no local grocery stores that people in those areas can access. And so they're forced to buy their groceries from gas stations. And so in this case, many of these gas stations started seeing this issue. And so what they started to do was that they started providing fresh produce that was locally grown at these stores in the name of being able to help these people. A more local example is Second Street Sundries, who recognized the need to integrate different autism spectrums into the job market to be able to provide them with job opportunities. They also donate money towards local autism organizations, and so they set up their restaurant model on solving this kind of problem. Now, you don't have to necessarily be a for-profit business to create these models. There are many nonprofit examples as well. One of those that you've probably heard of is Goodwill. They actually recognize a need within certain demographics that were underemployed. And so what they did was that they decided, okay, we're gonna take these people, provide them with job opportunities, and then from there, we're gonna give them job coaching, career training, and then help them to integrate back into the workforce. And so as a result, many of these different demographics include people who are older, people who are younger but not in college, people with autism, people coming out of prison or rehab. And so they have many local programs that are designed to help these people. Another example is Homes of Hope here in Stanley County, where they provide transitional housing for those coming out of rehab and struggling with drug addictions. That because of this, it's just simply affordable. And so these are just a couple of examples of some entrepreneurial ways to go about solving social issues that exist in your community. We all tend to make suppositions about our abilities, about where we fit in and what we deserve. And we often do so without really challenging these ideas. And by doing so, we tend to accept limitations that are self-imposed and can stop us from taking on this entrepreneurial mindset to be able to go and solve these problems that exist in the community. And so one of the things, if you're going to be an entrepreneur, that you need to recognize is that problems are simply opportunities in disguise. You can go through and solve these problems and create entire business models off of it. This elementary and yet very powerful concept is the key to what so many businesses have basically founded what their purpose and their mission statements are. And so many of today's most successful companies, such as Apple, Ford, and Amazon, were based on these simple concepts. Apple makes reliable technology that people could access and could take with them places. Ford was the first car manufacturer to make affordable vehicles for people to use for transportation. And Amazon made shopping from home an option for many people. And so an entrepreneurial mindset requires us to be willing to push the limits of what we think we're really capable of. And to beyond just that, that means you have to go beyond your comfort zone and explore boundaries that are beyond these self-imposed limitations that we put on ourselves. And so there are many problems that we tend to struggle with. And we need to learn to recognize these problems are really opportunities. And then from there, you have to choose to find a solution to many of these problems that exist in the world. And then from noticing these problems, you have to choose to take action, which in my opinion is really the most important thing, because if you don't ever act upon your convictions, they will never become a reality. And so That is what it takes to be an entrepreneur. You have to be willing to recognize opportunities. And then from that, solve those problems, and you have to make a deliberate choice to do that. And then from there, you have to act upon it. And so, as a result, I want to challenge all of you guys to be able to start to take on an entrepreneurial mindset in your own lives. You will probably notice, and even already do, problems that exist within your community of social issues and of social responsibility that you can find solutions to. And so, as a result, you can go through and actually start to solve and to become the solution to many of these problems. And so, with that said, I'd like to introduce our next speaker. His name is Lamont Bird. He is the CEO of Bird Corporations and is a motivational speaker that travels state to state speaking at business seminars, conferences, school events, and hosts workshops. He was featured on the Steve Harvey Show and received numerous leadership and appreciation awards. So with that said, Steve Harvey.
Thank you. How y'all doing today? You're good? Come on, y'all can do better than that. How y'all feeling this morning?
Good.
Good. One more time. How y'all feeling this morning?
Good.
I think y'all still a little asleep though. Still a little asleep? That's all right. I think I'm too nervous to still be sleepy. I actually went to bed at 1 this morning and woke up at 5. So I'm not tired anymore. So thank you for that. So my name is Lamont Bird. And first, I would just like to say thank you to Alicia for inviting me. Thank you, Mike, for your awesome presentation, as well as Amy. And I also want to acknowledge your president, Dr. Enemite. Did I say it right? Dr. Enemite, I appreciate him as well for speaking with me and introducing. I know he had to leave. So I want to pretty much jump straight into it. Okay, great, this is better for me. I like the walk, is that all right with y'all? Okay, this makes me feel a lot better. So, even though you all were forced to come today, I want y'all to actually give yourself a hand for even coming. So come on and just clap it up for yourself. And I'm gonna tell you why. You coming today shows a lot. Shows a lot about yourself. So even though you were forced to come, that still shows a lot about you because you still have some type of interest, because you still have the option, and you still have the choice to stay at home and be in your bed. Even though you were forced because of class, you get your class hours, you can pretty much still get credit for being in school, even though you're not in school, which is still a good deal for me as a student. You know, if I had the opportunity where I can just go to an event and still get credit hours, that's good for me. I'll do it any day. But due to the fact that you're still here, that shows a lot. That shows that you're interested. That shows that you're willing to actually be more innovative or learn how you can be better, how to better yourself. So that shows a lot. One of the things I want to talk about is I want to briefly give you some information about me, about what I do and where I come from. Originally, I'm from Detroit, Michigan. I grew up on the east side of Detroit, and on the east side of Detroit is pretty much a lot of poverty. It's a lot of pretty much just like the projects where you're not really privileged as much, such as with your public school systems and things of that nature. So that's where I grew up under. However, I still graduated from middle school, I graduated from high school, and then I went off to college. And so when I went to college my first year, of course, with statistically, they say with the freshmen, being a freshman in college, you don't take advantage of it. And just so happened, I fell right into that statistic. So I went to college, I got on financial aid probation, due to the fact that I was not going to class, I was partying all the time. I wanted to do whatever I wanted to do because that was the first time I left home. Like, I left home. I felt really good. I'm like, hey, I'm grown now. I left the house. You can't tell me what to do. You know, I think all of us been through that. Raise your hand if you've been through that with your parents. So I was at that point. I'm like, hey, you know, you can't really tell me what to do. So I wanted to do whatever I wanted. However, I did not know that it was going to backfire. To be completely honest, I really didn't want to go to college, to be honest with you. I never thought I would be in college. I never thought that I would graduate, that I'd be on my way graduating. I graduated in this May from Livingstone College with a bachelor's in business administration. Oh, appreciate it. Thank you. But the thing is, I never thought that I would go to college because I never had that interest. I never was interested with being an entrepreneur, per se. Even though my father is an entrepreneur, he works, and then as soon as he comes from his 9-to-5, he goes straight to doing landscaping, and that was his second hustle. That was his second job. He owned a landscaping company. So I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to be what he was. I did not want to go to college. But the reason what made me go to college, if I can be honest, the reason why I wanted to go to college is because of what I heard of what college is like, such as partying. So that's what made me go to college. But what I realized today is nothing just happens. And the reason why I say that, because if I never would have went to college and if I never have done the things that I've done, and to really get kicked out and have that time to myself, I wouldn't be where I am today. So around 2010, I'm home, and I was presented an opportunity a year later to come to Salisbury, North Carolina. I did not want to go because I'm a city boy. I'm from Detroit, Michigan. All I know is city. Really, I never been outside of Detroit before at that time. You know, I'm like, hey, I don't know about North Carolina. I heard about it. Charlotte, okay, Salisbury, that sounds small. I really don't want to go. But I ended up going, and that changed my life. The reason why it changed my life is because I decided to jump and take a leap of faith and do what was best for me and to take on an opportunity that could benefit me and change my life forever. So I went to Livingstone, and as I was at Livingstone, my first year, it was okay. But then my second year at Livingstone, I began to really dive into speaking. And you'll know while I'm telling this story. I began to really dive into speaking. And the reason how I started speaking was I started speaking at church events at youth. Like, my pastor made me talk to youth. I'm like, hey, pastor, you know, I'm from the hood. I don't really speak. Like, that's not really my thing. So he really pushed me to speak. So I started speaking. And after that, I began to travel. And when I started traveling, that pushed me to start sending out like inspirational posts on like Instagram, Facebook. And I'm like, hey, you know, this is my thing. Like, okay, cool, I can do this. So I began speaking, but what I did not know is while I was speaking and I was working at IHOP, being a server and going to school, I felt myself still not happy. I still wasn't happy with where I am today. Back then, I was like, hey, I'm not happy. I don't know why I'm not happy. But the reason why I was not happy was because I wasn't doing something that I genuinely love. I was doing partial, but I wasn't giving it my all. And a lot of times we do something and we don't give it our all. We'll dive into something that we love, but we find out that we're still not happy. And the reason why we're still not happy is because even though we may give it our all, we may give it 100%, the thing is we're not giving it 150%. We're not going above and beyond of what we can do. We're not going above and beyond our capabilities. We're not going above and beyond with our dreams. We're not going above and beyond with our vision. So I had a problem with that. I had a problem with me not putting my all into it. So what happened is, a couple years later, even though I've been traveling doing it, I felt myself going into a depression type of mode where I was stuck in my room for about a week or two. And it got so bad to the point where my friends came and they buzzed down my door in my college dorm apartments. And I got fined for that, by the way. It cost like $400 just for the door. And I'm like, but y'all did it, though. But so I had to pay for it, right? But anyways, they buzzed down the door. And they was trying to find out what was going on. But after that, I made up in my mind that I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I say, hey, Lamont, I like helping people. I like helping businesses. Like, I'm just that type of person. I have knowledge with how to make businesses grow. And this is what I want to do. I've actually been teaching at like youth events, so maybe I can speak and empower people. So I made that decision. So in 2015, I opened up my business, Bird Corporations, which is a business consulting company, and we manage companies as well. So I opened that up, but I was still working at T-Mobile. And I found myself still not happy because I'm helping, and this is my standpoint, I'm helping somebody else's vision, and I'm giving them my all when I can be doing the same thing for my own self. Y'all see what I'm saying? I was one of the top sellers of T-Mobile. Literally, every month I've had T-Mobile, I let T-Mobile make $14,000 off of me was my sales every month. And one day I was sitting at home, and I'm like, yo, T-Mobile was getting $15,000 from me like every month. And I said, what if I can use that same energy, apply that same energy of me working for somebody to my own vision and to my own dreams? So maybe I won't make only $15,000. Maybe I can make $20,000 a month. Like, hey, man, I'm a top seller. I'm good. Like, yo, maybe I can do it. So that's what inspired me, because I'm like, even though I'm working for somebody and I'm helping their business grow, what if I can work for myself and help my business grow? So I started Bird Corporations. And then as of last year, I became the owner of a family company, landscaping company, back in Detroit, Michigan. And with the landscaping company, that's growing, that's doing well with employees. And then I became a life coach last year. I was taking classes, was about to get certified, until I actually did research and I learned that you ain't really had to get certified. So I'm like, cool, man, I'm already in school. I ain't trying to be in school two times in a row, you know. So I became a life coach, and then I just finished writing two books, and I'm a full-time student with seven classes at Livingstone College right now, about to graduate in May. So you're saying, how can you own two companies, be an author, a life and business coach, and a motivational speaker, and still take seven classes? Yes, it's stressful, like every day. However, it's how bad you want it. I want it that bad where I'm not limited. You're not limited. Even though you're a student, that does not mean you're limited to your dreams and your visions. Just because you're a student or just because you're a millennial, you're young, that does not mean that you are limited to what you can do right now. Even though people or even your parents may say something about you or may say that, hey, you can't do this yet, you can't do that, or what you're going to do when you graduate college, that is maybe the most popular question you will always get asked if you're a student. Who believes me on that one? Like, oh, what's your plan after college? What's your plan after college, right? But the question is, what is your plan after college? So maybe your parents be like, hey, are you going to get a good job? Or, hey, are you going to do this or are you going to do that? But you have the power to do whatever you want to do. You have the power to own the company that you want to own. You have the power to even work for somebody and still own your own business. But the thing about doing that is balancing. You have to learn and know how to balance. So what happened is, if I work a 9 to 5, when I get off at 5, I'm going to dedicate 2 hours to my own company and to my own dreams, to my own visions, I'm gonna dedicate 2 hours. See, sometimes people think because they're working for somebody that their dreams are shot. Just because you work for somebody does not mean you cannot accomplish your own dreams. Just because you work for somebody does not mean that your vision and what you have and what you want to do for your life is done. What is called is discipline, is management, is balancing. And that's the importance when it comes to being an entrepreneur. It's all about balancing. Because there's entrepreneurs who's married. So you got to know how to balance work, and you have to learn, if you have to know how to balance family, you have to learn how to balance your wife or your husband. Mm-hmm. She said, true that. So, and that's work itself. So you have to know how to balance. So say that you own multiple companies. There's balancing with everything that you do in life. Even as a student and an entrepreneur, you have to balance. So it's possible. So don't think it's impossible, or don't think you're at a disadvantage because you're a student. Because in reality, when you're a student, you have the greatest advantage. And you're going to say, how? You have the greatest advantage because you have resources. You have resources that people don't have that's not in school or haven't been in school. You have resources such as, from here, you have the Small Business Center that offers free seminars and free classes, free courses, tutors. You have the resources to be able to network and connect with other people. And the greatest advantage that you have over people who are not students is you have less bills. So when you have less bills, that means that you have more finances to actually reinvest into your dreams. Because it takes money to make money. It takes money to make money. Don't think that you can start a business and you're not going to put no type of money or effort into it. It's not going to happen. When you see YouTube clips or say that you can get a free business and stuff like that, that's not true. Because it takes money to make money. It takes money to finance resources so that you can reproduce more than what you brought in. And I know that's what a lot of us, especially as millennials, struggle with, is feeling as if they're at a disadvantage with being a student, or feel as if they don't have the resources. But as a student, you have the greatest resource. You have the greatest resource because you can wake up and leave from class and be up all night writing your business plan or writing down whatever that you want to do. Oh, yeah, I'm in cosmetology school right now. However, I plan on owning my own salon. Oh, yeah, they charging like $350 a booth. Oh, every month. Oh, if I calculate that within a year, or maybe I can just reinvest that into my business and that can be a down payment on a rental building. That's simple. People think it costs a lot of money to start a business, but it doesn't. It doesn't. In reality, you spend more money daily when you could have reinvested. And it's from little things. It's from little things. So what made me, you may ask, what made me become an entrepreneur? I became an entrepreneur because every day or every time I saw a homeless person, I felt bad and it frustrated me because I did not have the resources and I was not the opportunist for them to be able to provide them a job. When I saw a homeless person, I see them with their signs, willing to work for money or work for food. I have a family. That hurts me because maybe if I was an entrepreneur and maybe if I had my own business and maybe if I had the resources, I could be able to give them that job. Maybe I don't have to give them money. Maybe I can be like, hey, come with me for 3 hours. I want you to do something. I'll pay you. Or maybe if I was an entrepreneur, I had rental properties, maybe that I can have them do something, do some work for me, and have them stay at the house at one of my rental properties and let him save his money up. And then he leave and I changed his life. So that made me want to be an entrepreneur was because I wanted to be the opportunist. I wanted to be the one that can provide opportunity for those who's looking for opportunity. I wanted to be the one that can give people the opportunity to change. Not for me, but to change for themselves. Certain people feel as if they can't change because they don't have the resources. So I wanted to be the one that was the resource that they have and that they need in order for them to change. So that's why I wanted to be an entrepreneur. Another reason why I wanted to be an entrepreneur was because of my father. I was raised by my father. I have one sister. My sister's from my mother's side. And I was raised pretty much by myself. I'm my father's only child. Some say that I'm spoiled. I don't think so. It was just because I was the only child. But I worked for everything I did. However, I saw my father struggle. Growing up, I saw my father struggle. And the thing was, I saw him struggle with having a business and working for the city of Detroit. I saw him struggle from getting up at 5 in the morning every day, getting off at work at 3:30, coming straight home, loading up the truck with his lawn equipment, being back out by 4:30, not getting back home until 9:30, every day, from Monday to Saturday. So you're saying like, okay, Lamont, what are you talking about? What I'm saying is that limited me from having the opportunity to bond with my father due to the fact that he was trying to be a provider. When I seen him struggling, that made me make up in my mind that I wanted to change, that I wanted to own my own company because, for one, I don't want to struggle no more. I refuse to struggle. I told myself, I said, if I'm going to struggle, I'm going to give myself the struggle with owning my own stuff. I made up in my mind I did not want to struggle working for another company when I can be struggling working on my own visions. So I didn't want to struggle. And another thing was it limited him from having the opportunity to leave when you want. So I wanted to be an entrepreneur because I'm saying, hey, you know, when I get kids one day or when I get married, I want to be able to go to my son's basketball game whenever I want to, or my daughter's dance or cheerleading or whatever. I don't have kids right now. I'm just saying for future-wise. that's what I wanted. I wanted that freedom. I wanted that flexibility. Not only, it's not always about finances. Don't get me wrong. It is because you got to eat and you got to live. But it's about the opportunities that come with being an entrepreneur. One of the opportunities with being an entrepreneur is the flexibility. The opportunity to be able to take your own dreams, your own vision, put your own twist to whatever you want to do. And that's what I wanted to do. And for me, I didn't like people telling me what to do. I'm like, hey, no, like, listen, that's just not going to work out. You know, you're limited when you're not doing things that you want to do. You feel as if you're stuck. You feel as if you're in a shell. You feel as you can't go where you want to go. Because in reality, they're controlling you. There's a time where you have to wake up in the morning. There's a time where you got to go to sleep. And there's a time where you got to take your lunch break. And I didn't want that. And I was tired. In fact, I had gave T-Mobile, I gave them a month in advance, and I let them know when I was going to be done. And within this May, it'll be 1 year that I have been doing it full time, working for myself. And it has been the greatest thing. But the thing is, it has not been easy, and it never will be easy. You see entrepreneurs such as Steve Jobs having Apple company, having billions of dollars. You would think, oh man, he living that life. He has $1 billion. He can do whatever he wants. He can buy whatever car. He can buy whatever house. He can buy whatever. Some people think that you can just buy happiness because you got a whole bunch of money. Who believe that, by the way? Who believe you can buy happiness if you got a whole bunch of money? Nah, kinda. Tell me why. Yeah, I mean, some people believe that. But the thing is, it's still not easy. And it's like the more money you have and the bigger your company gets, the more of a responsibility. So every level you go up to in life, there's a higher responsibility that you have to take on. So say, for example, when I just started Bird Corporations, that's all I had was just Bird Corporations. I was a student. It was okay. But then next thing you know, I didn't have employees like that. All I had was a partner that was with me and him just traded off and we did what we had to do. But then I took on a landscaping company last year and I got like 3 employees and I'm hearing every excuse in the book. Like, you know, so that was a more of a responsibility for me. Because not only am I managing my company in Charlotte, North Carolina, I'm in Detroit managing another company with employees while on top of managing another company in Charlotte. So you were saying, so how can you have a social life? You don't. You don't. But that's a part about, that's the whole thing, is when you love what you do and you want it as bad, you want to accomplish your dreams, you want to accomplish your visions, you want to accomplish your goals, everything else don't matter. You're willing to do what it takes. You're willing to actually take risk. You're willing to say, hey, you know what? I know I got to pay this bill, but I know this right here has to be paid within my business, which can make me more money. You have to weigh it out. You have to make those decisions, and those are hard decisions to make because you have to risk possibly getting in debt. You have to risk possibly maybe getting evicted from your apartment. You may have to actually get late fees on bills, but that's a part of the whole process, especially when you're starting off as an entrepreneur. When you're starting off with your small business, it's going to take that. It's going to take that discipline. It's going to take sacrifice. When you're going for your dreams and you're going for your goals, it's all about sacrifice. All the times when you used to hang out with friends every day or maybe every Saturday you just did a little girls' night or a boys' hangout, that's over. Because you cannot be inconsistent with your dreams. You will not succeed with being inconsistent, and that's with life. That's with your grades, that's with school, that's with doing homework, that's with studying. Everything that you do in life, you have to remain consistent. Because if you're inconsistent, then you're going to fall behind. And the way that life's set up, if you're falling behind, you're going to wake up sooner or later. Because life don't care. The world don't care about you lacking. So you have to make sure that you're on your A game every day. You have to make sure that you're willing to put in 150% going above and beyond with what you can do. Because truth of the matter is, if you're a business owner and you have clients, they don't care with what you're going through. They don't care about your personal issues. They don't care if you're sleepy. They don't care if you're losing sleep to accomplish something that they want you to do. They don't care about nothing. All they care about is the agreement that you two have. So you have to be willing to do what it takes. Y'all hear me? You have to do whatever it takes to succeed. Another thing I want to talk to you about is what is an entrepreneur? Can somebody tell me? Come on, somebody tell me. What's an entrepreneur? Anybody? Nobody knows? Okay, let me tell you. Entrepreneurs are game changers. Entrepreneurs are the opportunists. Entrepreneurs are the one that the world relies on. You say, so how can the world rely on entrepreneurs? Because entrepreneurs are the ones that provide the jobs. Entrepreneurs are the innovators. The innovators that comes up with different programs and different opportunities for those to be able to make money. Without entrepreneurs, this world would be kind of interesting, because entrepreneurs are the providers. Entrepreneurs are the ones, are the leaders in this world. There's so many different agencies right now, until this day, there's government funding for those who want to start up with a, who want to start a small business. And the reason why the government has funding right now and is desperate of those who start to start small businesses is because we are at a place where we need more small businesses. We're coming from the Great Recession, which was in 2007, 2008. When the economy went bad, now we're flourishing, everything is starting to look good. And so the government are looking for those to start more small businesses. So this is your opportunity. This is your opportunity. So you say, hey, yo, I'm a student, so how can I go ahead and get a small business loan? Just because you're a student does not mean that you can't get a small business loan. That doesn't mean anything. You can go to the SBA.gov and see the requirements of getting a small business. And it don't have to be a lot of money. It don't have to be $15,000. It doesn't have to be $50,000, $100,000. Some takes that amount. But even if you had $350, $350 can get you set up. $350 can get you an EIN, which is your federal information on your business, and that's for free. On IRS.gov, you can list your name on IRS.gov of your business and have a federal number. And then you can go to the state and pay a small fee, like $100, just to have your business in North Carolina, and that nobody can take it. And that's right there is already just for $100. Then you can spend another $100 on marketing. Then you can spend another $100 on whatever else that you need. So it does not take a lot of money to accomplish your goals. It does not take a lot of money to start your dreams, to start pushing your dreams, and start pushing your vision. It all depends on you. It all depends on what are you willing to do. So everything is up to you. So entrepreneurs are the game changers. Entrepreneurs are the trendsetters. Does anybody here know about bungee jumping? Y'all know what bungee jumping is? Can you tell me what bungee jumping is? The guy in the back. Right. So what he said is, it's pretty much somebody jumping off a bridge. You have your ropes tied to your ankles, you jump, and it lifts you back up. It's like a flex, rope, and it's pulling you back up. You just keep bouncing, me personally, I don't think I would ever bungee jump because me and heights don't get along. I'm not gonna be on the bridge with a rope tied to my ankles and I'ma just jump right over some water or some land. I don't operate like that, not me. Anybody will bungee jump in here? Will anybody bungee jump? You will bungee jump? Awesome. Yeah, I couldn't do it. I commend you. But see, the thing about bungee jumping is, bungee jumping is like entrepreneurship. Bungee jumping is all about jumping and taking risks. So let's use a name. Let's say his name is John. John goes to the bridge, all of his homeboys, they bungee jump twice a month. And when they bungee jump twice a month, they go in the morning. And what he does is he ties the rope on his ankles and he jumps. And when he jumps, he's jumping over a river. But entrepreneurship is just like John. When it comes to entrepreneurship, you have to jump. You can't be at the cliff of a bridge and never jump. You can't have your dreams and your visions and never jump. You can't say that you want to do this and you want to do that, or I'm going to do this, I'm going to that, or another common one is I'm about to do this, I'm about to do that, and never do it. So many people are about talk with no action. So the no talk with no action is being at the cliff of the bridge and never jumping. And what happens is when you're at the cliff of the bridge and you never jump, it's because of fear. So many people are afraid of jumping because they fear, hey, I have a kid, I have kids, I have a job, I have stuff to lose. That's very common. But I get that. But that's the reason why you need to jump. Because if you have kids and you have something to lose, then that means you need to jump because you have to do better. You have something that's watching you. You have somebody's watching you. So out of anybody, you're the one that need to jump. So many times we make up excuses for jumping. We make up excuse to cover our fear with jumping off the bridge. But there's no excuses. It's impossible to have an excuse to take risk to jump to accomplish with whatever you want to do. So you have to be a risk taker. You have to take risk. Entrepreneurship and being successful, you have to take a risk. You have to put in the work. Again, you will hear me say this whole time today. How bad do you want it? You have to put in the work. You have to jump. You have to be willing to jump to see the outcome. So John jumps. John jumps off the bridge. But see, the great thing about being with John bungee jumping, he goes twice a month, right? So the thing is, each and every time he goes to jump, the risk is less every time. The risk is less because he knows what he's doing more and more and more. The more times he jumped, the more he learned about that experience. And the more he learned about that experience, the more he wanted to do it again. So that's why they go twice a month, because they love it. So what are you saying, Lamont? What I'm saying is the more times you jump and you leap for it and you do whatever you have to do, the less of a risk it's going to be, because you've done this before. It's only a risk to you because you never done it. So you think as if you don't, you think as if you do it and you fall, you failed. You didn't fail. As Mike said earlier, you only fail when you don't do it. And a quote I say all the time that I made is, failure is not a loss. Failure is a lesson. Failure is not a loss. Failure is a lesson. When you fail, you learn something. When you fail, you learn, hey, okay, I succeeded at this one part, but I failed at this, so what can I do better? Failure is that opportunity to correct whatever you did wrong. Just because you failed that, it does not mean that you're a failure. It does not mean that you're not qualified for doing whatever you want to do. It means that you're trying to perfect with what you want to do. Oprah, Steve Harvey, Steve Jobs, how you think they all became successful? It's because time after time, they're jumping. Time after time, they're willing to take in with whatever they have to do. Time after time, they're going to say, hey, man, I'm on this bridge, I'm going to jump. Because it's the thrill of jumping. The thrill is wanting to see that outcome when you jump. See, John, he understands that when he jumped, the risk is my rope could snap and I can fall flat on my face. But it's a less of a risk because I keep doing this. So I know the proper tools and I know the proper way to strap myself to make sure I'm safe. So when I jump, I know that I'm bouncing back. So what I'm saying is, The more you do it, the more you become a risk taker, the more successful you'll be. Because the more things you learn due to failing, more things you learn because you tried it. Don't be afraid to try. Even though you're in school, don't be afraid to try and accomplish your dreams. Being a hairstylist, there's nothing wrong with looking at some buildings, finding out how much it costs to rent, finding out how much you can possibly maybe get a couple group of your students that's graduating with you and say, hey, how about I offer you a booth at my own building, and that booth rent can take the rent of your building, and whatever you're making with your booth could be your profit. That's simple. That's you jumping and taking that leap of faith. That's you jumping and taking that risk. But the whole idea is you have to make it happen. So don't be afraid to be a risk taker. Another thing I want to talk to you about is another story. And this comes from a movie. And in this movie, there's three skaters. And two skaters are watching this one skater because they're getting ready for nationals. They're getting ready for nationals, their skate off. And this one skater keeps trying this one trick. And every time he tries this one trick, he keeps falling. And so the guy questioned the other guy who's watching. They say, yo, why he keep trying this one trick and he keeps falling? And so the other guy tells him, he said, why not? He said, how will you know how to get up if you never fail? How will you know what it's like to get up from something if you've never fallen? How can you coach somebody else what to do if you've never done it? How can you be the leader and you didn't experience that? So how can you know what it's like to fall and you never fail? So the thing about this story is, even though this skater kept falling, every time he failed, when he got back up, it took him longer to fall because he was perfecting that one move. And he kept doing it over and over and over and over again until he perfected that one move. Entrepreneurship is the same way. Success is the same way. It's a system. You find it. And you keep doing the same thing until you get it right. You keep trying. You keep trying. Oh, this business didn't work out. Try it again. You keep trying. Oh, I had this one idea. I was trying to implement it, but it didn't work. Try another one. Keep trying. Keep trying. Don't limit yourself with what you can do. Because you can do more and you can do better than what you think you can. Just because you say, hey, well, I come from a small town, there's less opportunities, some may say, that does not mean anything because there's still opportunities. The only thing is you have to learn how to utilize the opportunities that's in front of you. So utilizing these opportunities will help you to take your success to another level. So don't be afraid to be a risk taker. Don't be afraid to jump. How bad do you want it? A motivational speaker that I look up to, his name is Eric Thomas. And Eric Thomas, he says this quote all the time, and it's so profound to me. He said, do you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe? Do you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe? Do you want success as bad as you're trying to catch your breath? So I'm going to tell y'all something about me. So me, I snore, okay? I kind of snore kind of loud sometimes. Sometimes I wake my own self up. And what I have, I kind of diagnose my own self. I say, you know, maybe I just have sleep apnea, which is kind of bad probably. So sometimes I wake up not breathing, right? But watch this. I wake up not breathing, but when I wake up not breathing, I'm trying to gasp for air. I'm trying to gasp for air. But because it's so common with me, there's three things I learned to do. Three things that work out for me to breathe. And the first thing that I do is I remain calm. I learned how to be calm. The second thing is I focus. And the third thing is I breathe in slowly, in and out. And those three things are all combined into one word, which are called a strategy. And the way success is, there are strategies that you need for the system of success. My strategy to cause me to breathe was to remain calm, to focus, and to breathe in slowly. That's my strategy. So how bad do you want it? How bad do you want to see? Do you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe? Do I want to succeed as bad as I was trying to catch my breath? Do you want to succeed as bad as you wake up in the morning? Do you want your dreams bad enough where you just don't care what happens because this is better for you? Because you want to take your life to the next level. Because maybe you want to take your parents out of their current home and you want to put them in something bigger. You want to put them in something nicer. You want to drive something better. And that's okay. You see yourself in a different state. You see yourself in another city. You see yourself in another element. Push. Do it. Be that innovator. Don't be afraid to be that innovator. But there's hardships when it comes to being a risk taker. There's hardships when it comes to being an entrepreneur. And one of the hardships is not having sleep. Those are one of the hardships with being an entrepreneur, is not getting enough rest. There's going to be times where you just won't have the ability to sleep. For example, for me, I only slept for 4 hours. Why? Because I was up taking care of business and doing schoolwork. So I had to go to bed at 1 a.m. and get up at 4. There's going to be times where you may lack eating because you forgot, because you were too busy doing whatever you have to do. Then it goes back to what I said earlier, social life. There's going to be times where you're going to have to sacrifice from going out to do your schoolwork so that you can do your business work in the morning, or vice versa. One of the hardships is no sleep. The other hardships are anxieties. Wanting to be depressed, stressed a lot. Another one is the temptation to wanting to quit. The temptation of wanting to say, you know what, man, I just want to just throw this away. I just want to give up. That was me last year, and it happens all the time. It's common. I was at a point where I'm like, man, listen, I'm a student. I was blaming it on being a student. I'm a student. I just maybe just need to focus on school, graduate school, and maybe I can just pursue whatever I want to do. Maybe I just go ahead and get a job and do whatever I got to do. Oh, my business is not bringing in enough money. I have bills. I have a car note. I have an apartment, da-da-this, da-da-that. Maybe it's just not working out. Maybe I should stop. Maybe I should quit. Those are one of the temptations, is wanting to quit, but you can't. Because this is all about you. It's all about how you want it. You can't quit because this is your baby. When it comes to wanting to be successful, when it comes to being an entrepreneur, that's your baby. It's a process. You birthed it. Entrepreneurship is like a pregnancy. This is about to get interesting to y'all, huh? Y'all say, yo, this is like a pregnancy? It's like a pregnancy. Because then it starts out with an idea, and it's in you. It's a small idea. And this is what's on your mind. This is what's on your heart. It's a small idea. But then the idea grows, and it gets bigger, and it gets bigger. And then it gets heavy on you. And it gets so heavy on you, where you're to a point where it's either A, you have to do something about it, or B, you're doing something about it and you just want more. This is your baby. It's getting bigger, it's getting bigger. And then you finally birth it. And when you birth it, you have to take care of it. Being an entrepreneur and working towards success, you have to take care of it. You have to be consistent. You can't leave it. You can't abandon it, because this is for you. This is your responsibility. So even though you want to sleep, even though you want to break, you can't. This is your baby. This is your responsibility. Success and being a business owner is the same exact way. That's your baby. This is the way you take care. You got to take care of it. This is all yours. So you can't give up and you can't give in. Don't cave into the hardships of being an entrepreneur. Don't cave in. You got to push through. How do you push through? You got to remain consistent. Build a formula. Build a habit of the things you do. Hey, boom. For example, what I do is I wake up in the morning and I meditate. What that consists of, I get out of my bed, I sit up, and I remain quiet. I close my eyes. After that, I normally say a prayer, and then I look at, well, what I can do for the day. What are my goals for the day? I write them down. And then I have a process where that's when I start getting ready and do what all I have to do. That helps me to stay in tune with wanting that mindset of wanting to give up. I can look back at my goal sheet and be like, oh man, I can't. I have this to do today. I have this to do tomorrow. I have this to do within the next hour. Or maybe I didn't do everything today. And that happens, and that's okay. But you got to make it up. So when you have a habit and you have goals set, that helps you to push through, because that encourages you to let you know that you have something going for yourself. So if you don't write goals, start writing your goals down. Because your goals will help you to stay motivated and to help you to see that you can accomplish your dreams and you can do whatever you want to do. Another thing is, put in your 150%. Go all the way. If you're going to do it, do it. You can do it. Everybody in this room has the opportunity to be successful. Everybody in this room has the ability, the skills, and the knowledge to be successful. The only reason why everybody will not be successful is because you will not apply your knowledge, your skills, and your abilities. But you can't be lazy, because it's not where you come from and it's not where you are right now. It's about what you can produce and what's to come in your future. So don't blame yourself on where you're at right now, because you can do it. You can have and own your own mechanic shop. You can have your own salon. You can have your own fashion boutique. You can have whatever you want to do, art, drawing, books. You can do it all. But it's all start within you and with what you want to do and how bad you want to do it. And the last thing I want to say, and I'm going to get out of here because I know it's about my time. I want to tell you this story and I'm going to be done. There's two brothers. There's two brothers, and they grew up with a father and their mother. But the mother left the father because he's an alcoholic. So the brothers grew up, and they got interviewed. So one of the interviewers, they asked one of the brothers, and one of the brothers are an alcoholic, and the other brother is successful. So he asked the alcoholic, he said, what made you become an alcoholic? And he said, because my father was an alcoholic. And then he asked the successful brother, he said, what made you be so successful? He said, because my father was an alcoholic. The whole point of the story is, it does not matter where you come from. The successful brother became successful because he had a mindset. He was bound and determined to do whatever he had to do to never be exactly like the way he grew up. He was bound and determined not to be like his father. He was bound and determined not to be how his mother left him. He was bound and determined to be more for himself than what people told he was worth. So I just want to encourage you to keep pushing, and that you can be successful, and that you can be an entrepreneur even in your current situation, even as a student. Even if you're working for somebody, you can still accomplish your goals and your dreams. And that's my time. My name is Lamont Byrd. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Well, I certainly, go back to this. Do I have? Well, I certainly appreciate your time, Lamont. Thank you so much. And thank you each and everyone that has been in attendance. And our presentation is not over yet. I hope that that was encouraging to you, and that maybe you're starting to see yourself possibly as an entrepreneur. And so the next part of our presentation is talking about some opportunities in entrepreneurship. Again, I hope that you've already maybe considered, well, this is what I want to do, and this is where I can see myself being a successful business owner. But if not, there are opportunities right here in Stanley Community College that you could take advantage of to prepare yourself for a position in entrepreneurship. Mike, would you like to introduce our program heads?
I don't know them all.
Okay. I'll assist.
You assist me. Okay. Let's see. Who's here? Who wants to speak first?
We have William. I know Billy's here.
Billy, come on down, Billy. We're going to have each one of our program heads, or the program heads that are here today, talk a little, just 2-3 minutes about their program. And what it has to offer. Many of you are already students in one program or another, but you never know what you're going to do once you graduate. Billy Honeycutt.
Hello, everybody. I'm program head over the automotive collision repair program, and our job, or my goal each and every class that I have, is to put my students to work. I've been doing this myself for about 40 years, and I know it's a very rewarding field to be in. And so my goal is just to put my students to work. So we go through a one-year program. Our students get a diploma for that one-year program, and they're going to be learning general body repair in their first fall semester. Spring, they're going to be learning paint refinishing, and in the summer semester, they're going to learn frame repair, which is structural, heavy equipment. So that's what they go through. I tell you, all these people that's come up here and spoke, you really need to take heed to what they said. Some very good information up here. I will say I myself came to this school in 1977. Took the auto body collision program myself, had no clue that I would be going anywhere, I guess you say, successful. My goal was just to fix cars, work on cars the rest of my life, and that was going to be it. But things changed, and they changed quickly. Shortly after I got out of school and I went to work in a body shop, I was offered the opportunity to go to work at a separate dealership. So while at that dealership, I was offered the job of manager. So I became manager of a dealership body shop, and I'd only been out of school for about 3 to 4 years. Didn't have a clue. So you have opportunities here that can better prepare you for a situation like that that I did not have. So I had to learn mine by trial and error. So you need to take advantage of these opportunities. But shortly after I became manager of that shop, I was offered an opportunity to be manager at a large independent. And then while I was at large independent, I eventually decided I'd open my own company. So I did open my own business, and I'd only been out of school for about 10 years. And after opening that company, within 1 year, I opened a second location. So I had two locations in two different towns. And then shortly after that, I opened a second company. So I had two companies in two separate towns. And as Lamont was saying, it takes everything you've got. Owning your own business is not easy. It's not an easy road. It takes everything away from your personal life, and it drains you. So any chance you get from this college that these people can help you, it will make your road a little easier, and I recommend you take it. You do need to focus on your goals. If opportunities come along, you need to grab them. You can't ever learn too much. School is something you need to focus on the rest of your life. I was in school last week. I take classes all the time, constantly. So take advantage of these opportunities. Doesn't matter if you're in cosmetology or if you're in welding or collision repair or whatever. You need to take advantage of every opportunity you get. They don't come along very often. So.
Thank you, thank you. Mr. Beaver, would you be willing to go next?
Thank you. Are we killing the battery?
Yeah.
Good morning. My name is William Beaver. I'm program head here at welding at Stanley Community College. I am a product of the community college system. In 1975, yes, the last century, I went to Central Piedmont and took auto mechanics. I finished that, and I pretty much figured I was the best damn mechanic in North Carolina, and that's all I needed to know. And after about 3 or 4 months at Ben Mine and Chevrolet, I realized that that wasn't the only way to go, so I went back to school and started my associate's degree in business. So I was working at Ben Mine at Chevrolet in Concord, got off at 5 o'clock in the afternoon in Concord, drove all the way to downtown Charlotte. Now it wasn't as bad then as it is now, but it was pretty bad. I went to school 4 nights a week till 11 o'clock, drove home from Charlotte at 11 o'clock Monday through Thursday, and was at the dealership at 7 o'clock when the doors opened. I got my associate's degree in business administration. I moved on. I ended up being the night foreman at Tar Heel Ford Trucks in Charlotte on Graham Street. They were the fifth largest Ford dealer in the world. And then I got the job of a lifetime. People said I was going to work at Philip Morris. We made cigarettes. Well, once you go to work at Philip Morris, you had a job for life. That job lasted 22 years till they closed the plant down. I'm sure you know people that work there. Well, about 7 years before they closed it down, I realized that it wasn't going to be around forever, so I went back to school at the age of 40, and I started my bachelor's degree in business, and I also started taking welding. I didn't finish my business degree. I need 2 classes for my bachelor's degree. I did finish my business. I have an associate's degree in welding. I have an associate's degree in motorsports. I've taught here at Stanley Community College. I've taught at Rowan Cabarrus. I've taught at Central Piedmont. I've taught motorsports. I've taught fabrication. I've taught welding. My daddy was a product of the Depression, and he always said, whatever you do, keep going to school. He said, they can take your family, they can take your money, they can take your life, but they can't take what you've learned. So as long as you go to school and learn and build on it like the other speakers have talked about, you'll never be poor. Because if you can work with your hands and you have a knowledge of how to do something, you can always provide for your family. We have a welding program here. We can do Con Ed or we can do curriculum. It's one of the few community colleges where in 1 year you can come out of here with a diploma in welding. We've been fairly successful putting students to work. The economy's turning around. Welders are in high demand. Down in the Amet building on 2427, I'm with Billy Honeycutt with Auto Collision. We also do heavy equipment. We also do machining and HVAC. So. All of you here in this room today, you're learning how to make a job like a living with your hands, and you're going to be very desirable in the future. Thank you.
As David's coming down, I wanted to say very quickly, you've had a great opportunity to listen to Billy's story, Williams, and David has a story as well. Please consider your instructors as mentors and not just instructors of the content and the material. They've got great stories, great experiences that you can build upon to then be successful in entrepreneurship. So again, I'm going to turn it over to David, but thank you again for sharing your stories.
Thank you. Well, I had not planned on speaking, so thank you for putting me on the spot today. But my name's David Smith, Program Director for Cosmetology Program here at Stanley. And a lot of times you hear the word cosmetology and you just think, oh, just hairdressers. But we're much more than hairdressers. We're doctors, we're lawyers, we're psychologists, we're your best friends, we're nurses, you name it. We're everything when people sit in our chairs, so we have a lot of power, which is a good thing with our profession. And as both the gentlemen said, they were products of the community college, so am I. I graduated here in the 90s with a diploma in cosmetology. All I wanted to ever do was open a salon and just fix people's hair and make them look pretty. And the last thing I ever wanted to do was become a teacher. And then my director at the time, she said, you know, I think you would make a good instructor. And I said, you're crazy. Crazy as a bed bug. I said, I have no desire to teach whatsoever. And so she just kept on and kept on and kept on. And I said, okay, if you'll shut up, I will take the instructor training program and make you happy. So that's kind of what I did and fell in love with it. And so as they say, the rest is history. So I do enjoy the teaching aspect as well as owning my own business, which I still do. And I've had that for almost 18 years. I've been a salon owner here in Albemarle. I started out right after I graduated school. Which I don't recommend, so my college students, you know, listen to me. Don't go right out of the gate trying to open a business because it's a little more difficult sometimes in our business. You have to build a business and then open a business from there, which is a good thing. But we encompass a great variety of things within our program. We also have a manicuring program. We have instructor training program that we offer here, and this fall we'll actually have our high school CCP pathway in our new cosmetology facility. And we're also going to try to start a CCP manicuring class. So we're hoping to have a full building soon here on campus. So any of you folks that are interested in cosmetology or manicuring or instructor training, if you're already licensed, come and talk to us. We'd be glad to talk with you folks and hopefully get you signed up. And for you auto body folks, welding people, you work in jobs where you're not air conditioned, so this summer when your heads are all sweaty and nasty and then you get finished, come on up and let our girls work on you. They'll make you feel a whole lot better. Thanks.
That's perfect. You really do want to take them up on that offer, by the way. Great manicures, great styling. So we'll just go down the row here. We've got some of our program heads right here on the front. So Miss Dana Cheney. Yes, perfect. And then those in the back.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see everyone here today. Want to ask a couple questions. What associate's degree does Mr. Beaver have? Business administration. Lamont from Livingstone College, what is his degree going to be in? Business administration. We see a theme here. Right? How many of us did not know what we wanted to be when we grow up and still don't know today? Okay. I was like that. When I got out of high school, I had no clue what I wanted to be when I grow up, and I still don't today. And my best friend, she told me marketing was fun. Okay, so that's how I picked my major. I chose to go into marketing. So I came here to Stanley Community College, and I took Introduction to Business. And it was fun. And I learned a lot. And then I transferred to UNC Charlotte and got my undergraduate degree into business. And I thought, I like this. This is for me. So I came up with a plan. How many of us have a defined plan for our career? Maybe a little one? Okay. Are you able to execute your plan? Like, mine got derailed, right? I was in marketing, working in what I went to school for. And one day I come back to my job and everybody I work with is gone. They're gone. They've been laid off. And I'm the only person they kept. And I've now been transferred to human resources. Okay, so can you plan a career today and have a solid career plan and just execute? No. Is there any such thing as job security today? No. But I will tell you that everyone in this room today owns your own business. You own your own careers and the ability to make your choices. And the book I would recommend to each of you is a book called The Startup of You. It's by Reid Hoffman, the founder of LinkedIn. And it will tell you how to manage your career, no matter where that career takes you as a business. So I invite you also to come here to Stanley Community College and take advantage of our business offerings. Get a lot of cause students in my business classes. We have fun talking about the realities of opening your own salon in a house or on the road. Had a student last semester that wanted to do a mobile beauty salon. So we research that as part of our class. We do a lot of hands-on things, a lot of case studies. We talk about being an entrepreneur in a small business or taking those innovative ideas and working it into a large corporation. So some of my students come in, they take intro to business, but others stay with me for the first year, and my entire first year in our business administration program will transfer to any school in the state. Okay, so then you can go right over to Charlotte or Pfeiffer or these other places. Or if you want to stay with me a little longer, we'll do full 2 years. And as you do that, you can pick up a certificate in marketing, in small business entrepreneurship. Okay, so there are a lot of opportunities. We've also added courses in project management because companies are really looking for that skill, and human resources management to help you learn how to work with other people. So if you want to come with me for one course, a year, 2 years, I welcome you to come and join us as part of the business administration learning community. And I have one quote for you today. It seems to fit in with where we've been going. Success is not final. We think we've got it, but then something changes. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. So I encourage you all, that was Winston Churchill, continue on with your dreams and come join us in business administration.
Good morning. My name is Elena Earhart. I am the new agribusiness technology instructor here. And so probably all of you are thinking that agribusiness has to do just with farming. Well, you are correct, but it also does with 1,000 other things. I went to school at Mount Olive College to major in agriculture education and decided to teach in the high school for 4 years and missed teaching the exciting parts of ag. And so when I learned about this job at Stanley Community College, it excited me because agribusiness is one of the most growing areas for jobs. Okay, if you think about anything, it relates back to ag. The food that is on your table is ag. When you walk into the grocery store, that food is there. All relates to agriculture, and every job that is out there, you can relate it back to ag. So agribusiness is definitely a growing area, and it's not just being on a farm and being hard work, but it is also, if you're sitting out here thinking that you want to be an entrepreneur and you want to start your local garden, or you want to grow something in your backyard, you're in the right spot, because ag has grants and money willing, the government is willing to help you start, because if you didn't know, the age of the farmer is 56 years old, okay? And the next person coming up is not there. So if you want to continue to walk into your Harris Teeter and find your food in a convenience, you better learn where it's coming from. And you better make some sure that some of your friends are going in to learn how to grow it too, because it is a problem that we are going to be facing soon. But we talk about that in the agribusiness program here. We're getting started, getting out in the community, working on partnerships to get you guys actually own farms to work with people. We're even talking with people trying to get a greenhouse here on campus so you get your hands-on education as well. So if you're interested in agribusiness technology, come find me. Thank you.
Well, it filled up. I'm Betty O'Neill, and I have three programs that I get to work with. One is the Auction School, which is a marketing course, Carolina Auction Academy. One is the real estate program. We do both pre- and post-licensing. And the other is the class for substitute teachers, if you want part-time things. But one of the things that always befuddles people, in fact, it's amazing how many people don't know we even have an auction school here. There are only three in the entire state of North Carolina, and we have one. But our program extends beyond the state requirements because we do teach the business part of it. Many times people think of the auction program as, oh, you're that person that talks fast. That is a tiny part of what you learn in the auction profession. People laugh and say that auctioneering is actually the second oldest profession because we've always made things disappear for money. So, but we have a good time in that class. It's 96 hours, and so it does lead you to the credentials you need to take the state exam. And once you have finished that, you can have a license to auction anywhere in North Carolina. Don't have to get additional privilege license and things like that in most areas. So we'd like to talk more with you about that because it is a fun class. National Auctioneers Association does a research program, and consistently the reason that people go to auctions is it's fun and it's also addictive. The other program that I coordinate that can get you right out and working very quickly is the real estate program, the pre-licensing program. If you talk to anyone who's ever taken it, myself included, it is a very hard class. But it's worth it in the long run. Once you get your North Carolina real estate license, again, you can go to work anywhere in North Carolina selling real estate, marketing real estate, doing property management, that type thing. So we're excited about those two programs, and what we see now is a combination. People will go through auction school and then they'll come back and take the real estate program, or they'll take the real estate program and then come back and take auction school because they do work nicely together. Everyone's talked about the community college. When I was in high school, which was probably before most of you were ever even thought of, even your parents probably, I'm sitting here looking at David and thinking, oh yeah, I remember him. we won't talk about that. But actually, when I was a high school senior, I was working part-time and in high school, and Wayne Tech in Goldsboro opened a branch of their college out at the Air Force Base. So I decided, hey, this is not a bad idea. So I went out and took two classes for college credit while I was going to high school and working. So I was able to enter college with already having courses behind me. Now that was in the dark ages, and now we're seeing that same trend come back, and you can get credits here that will transfer. So if you have any interest in either of those courses, or you just need a fill-in with substitute teaching, we know that teachers are always having to be away, and that's a good 30-hour course you can take. We do a fast track in the summer, four straight days and you're done, and then each semester we do one as well that meets at the night. So auction method of marketing is still alive and well.
My name is Claudia Gresham, and I'm over the University Transfer Program here. And how many of you have said these words in the last little bit? Only a few more months and I'm through school. Yeah, I know, I get it. But the truth is, with the way things are today, and we just don't have what we used to have, where you'd go work somewhere 30 years and retire. It's just really not out there like it used to be. So when you're in your careers now, you may finish in that very field. Or you may find that when you go to work, somebody says, you know what? You are supervisor material. I just need you to go back to school and pick up a business degree. Or I need you to go to the university and further that. You need to be open to it. But I know right now you're tired and you don't want to think about that being that. I just want to finish school and get a job and be done. Well, I'm going to bet that I am the oldest student in this room. Am I? Anybody older than 50 in here right now in school? In school right now? Huh? You taking classes? You beat me? There aren't many of us, because we're old as dirt, right? And who thought we'd end up going back to school? It was not in my plan, right? We had some upheaval in at work for a couple years, and things were just different. And then I looked around and realized I was old, and that no one would ever hire me because I was old, and that I needed something to sweeten up the old resume. So doggone it, I went back to school, and it has been a whole new experience. But you're never too old for this. And I felt I needed a new skill set. You may get to that place where you need a new skill set. Don't be scared of it. Look at it as an opportunity to expand and to grow. And that's what we do in the University Transfer Program. Ms. Cheney came up and spoke, and I'm sure Mr. Sperling will as well. We have worked together to create a program that seamlessly feeds to the university so that you can start and get a credential here. You finish what you're in right now. You get that first year credential through the business department, and then we will feed you onto the university. We also have a new Associate in Arts with Business program that you can actually get 2 full years and be ready to start at the university as a junior. And that would typically be where people would go, but you may get in what you're doing and decide, you know what, I don't like it. It's not for me. Several people had mentioned changing their minds a few times. I changed my major 9 times, okay? I didn't really know. It's hard to make the decision when you're just getting started what you're gonna be really good at. So you need to change. There probably would be some people who suggest that perhaps I chose poorly to begin with, but I found something I loved and I committed to it. And now I'm expanding on it. You may need to do the same thing. So keep an open mind to that and don't be afraid of it. Because if you're succeeding in what you're in right now, you can succeed in something else too. And we are here to help you do that. Stanley Community College tuition. Now I'm not talking about books or and all that stuff, but tuition alone is roughly $2,300 a year. When you look at going to a state school, you're right around 46, somewhere in there, 4,600 a year. That's tuition, not books, not parking passes, all that stuff. When you look at the private schools, some of them are around 23,000 a year plus. Yes, that's you? Yeah, and some of them are a lot plus, okay, like way on the other side of that. And so one of the ways to reduce the cost of that is to do your transfer courses here. Every university has gen ed courses at the beginning. Everybody takes English and they take math and they take science and they take all that stuff. That's what we can give you. So when you get in your program and you finish and you go, you know what, I feel like I need to grow with this. I need to take this a step further. I see myself doing some other things. Don't be afraid of it. We're here, we'll get you through it, and we'll help you continue to grow and be a lifelong learner. Thank you for your attention. I have some handouts. If anybody's interested, I'll just throw them. If you want some more information on that program, I'll have them up in the back.
All right, so the final portion of our morning is an entrepreneurs panel. So if you would make your way down here, our remaining entrepreneurs, we already have one settled in nicely. Philip Falcom. All right. Okay, so how this format will work, I went ahead and drafted a couple questions. We're gonna run through our panelists with those questions. But while we're speaking, please think of some questions of your own because we will open it up at the end if you have some questions for these individuals. So we have 4 panelists here this morning, each of them entrepreneurs. So I'm gonna let them introduce themselves within the first question, so I won't hold you up there. But again, please take this opportunity to learn from their experiences. I think we have a great panel here with us this morning, so thank y'all for coming. Jeranya. She's great. By the way, Jeranya's a student. I don't know if she's going to touch on that. Phil and Josh, they're employees. Sean's a student. So if you've still had trouble picturing yourself as an entrepreneur sitting in this crowd, don't. The panelists before you have a strong link to this college, and you could be just as successful as they are. But my first question for the panelist, what is your business and what product or service do you provide?
Is it on?
It is on. You just have to yell into it.
Okay. Hi, my name is Jeranya Burris. I'm a licensed massage therapist and I'm on East Midwest Therapeutic Massage and Wellness. And my service is offer traditional Thai massage, Swedish deep tissue, and sports and medical massage. Hot stones and all that good stuff.
That's awesome.
Hi, I'm Phil Balcom, and my company is Parlay Design Company, and I offer graphic design and help with marketing and specialize in logos and marketing pieces and mailers and things like that.
Awesome. My name is Josh Smith. I'm the owner operator of Husky Lawn Care. We try to help people on any budget manage their lawn. We don't really do any heavy style landscaping, but property management, if you have cleanup work that you need things done, We really try to be very versatile, and I'm a teacher here going on my 11th year in education. So, you know, when you work your job as an employee, you know, you got to get out there and make the money while the sun's shining, because that's your only time to do it. So,
how's it going?
Good.
I'm sure you guys are as tired as I am. So my name is Sean Singleton. I started a company several years ago called Brothers Keeper Firearms and Survival Training. I spent the better half of my adult life, initial adult life from 18 up, getting shot at. So I got tired of getting shot at, so I started teaching other people how to shoot, so I don't have to do it for them. So I teach everything from beginner firearms, survival training. A big one that I push is a situational awareness course. Most of it is to college age women, because that's the most susceptible age bracket and gender bracket. It's to teach you how not to put yourself in a bad situation before you have to react. And it's I do a lot of tailoring to, you know, actually I've got a salon up here on Ed and Red Cross that I'm actually going to teach them at their salon here in the next couple of weeks. It's helped my wife, it's helped my sister-in-law. Both have had some pretty sketchy instances happen, and because of the stuff that I taught them, they came out of it a little bit better. But I started it because there was nobody else in this area doing anything like that. And between law enforcement and the military background that I have, I saw a need for it and decided that you know, I needed to reach out and start teaching people how to protect themselves so they weren't dependent upon somebody else to do it.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. Kind of answered some of the next question, which is what caused you to start your business? Maybe yours wasn't being shot at, Josh.
No, mine wasn't being shot at, thank goodness. My biggest reason, I think, why I went into business was because a need of income. Those of you, if you have an educational background, you know that the pay is probably not the best. And when my wife and I got married, we went many years on just one income. It can be done. My wife, you know, just has worked so hard to get into a position of nursing. She does an amazing job at it. But when she came out of college, there was nothing around here for a health and wellness major. So I knew on a teaching income, we could pay most of our bills. But then at the end of every month, we just still had a deficit. And so I've always been the type of guy that I look for things to do for people. And I can turn a buck doing that. Even growing up, you know, mowing yards, washing trucks for people, doing cleanup. And I just kind of thought, you know, why not just continue that now? And I was able to, you know, have some access to credit, purchased a lawnmower back in 2008, and then it just grew. You know, what I thought was going to be mowing a few extra yards a week has turned into trying to manage about 60 to 70 accounts now. And it can be overwhelming at times, but, you know, it's one of those things that it is hard in today's time to make it on one income. And that's why I always try to tell, I've got 15 students in here, that if you are gonna make it, you need to have something on the side that you know to do, because it's a difficult thing. You need to have extra income from any possible angle. So that's my biggest reason.
That's perfect, thank you.
Well, I moved here from Thailand about 11 years ago, and been stay-home mom, taking care of my children. Now they are in school, so with my massage background from home and also went to school here in the States, I think I want to offer a service that, you know, to a local community with people that, you know, don't have to drive all the way to Charlotte for good service and stuff like that. So I think it's very rewarding that I can help a person, you know, get, you know, out of the pain or discomfort they may have. So. Yes.
Okay. And then, so for me, I was already doing, offering my services on the side, very, very part-time. And so the concept of starting a small business was to take what I was doing and putting it under a legit umbrella. And it's better for marketing because there's a company that I can market instead of just that guy that does that thing. You know, so that makes it a lot easier. So, I wanted to take the little bit that I was doing and try to turn it into additional income for my family and to help to grow something and give myself options later. I've got a full-time job and other ventures that I'm volunteering in outside of these, but to actually start a business, which is relatively inexpensive for me to do. You know, Lamont was talking about that earlier. It can be done cheaply, and have that available and that option was just something good to go ahead and do now.
That's perfect. Awesome. So our next question, what has been the most challenging situation you have faced in owning a business?
I think personally for me, it's a sacrifice. If you want to own a successful business, it's going to take time away from things that you enjoy. I used to be an avid hunter and fisherman. I don't think I've gone in probably 10 years just because a lot of times in the winter, leaves have to be collected, people need things done, and you just have to make those sacrifices. I think my biggest challenge happened in the year 2010. Got really sick with an autoimmune disease, and it made it very difficult for me to get my job done. I thought at some points I was going to lose my business because I got really indebted to some things. But, you know, thankfully had a lot of support and pulled through it. And so I would probably say that just, you know, that and knowing that you sacrifice the things that you enjoy to do to have a business. But you really hope that down the road those sacrifices will pay off in other ways for yourself and for your family and for those that will benefit from your entrepreneurship.
That's a good one. That's a big one that you're going to deal with. Mine that I still deal with regularly is self-doubt. You know, it's, you know, am I good enough to be able to do this to the ability that I want to do it at? I mean, I'm providing a service that's potentially saving somebody's life, but am I as good as the guy down the road or the guy you watch on YouTube or the guy on TV or anything else? So, I mean, I'm constantly always making myself better. I hate the term expert, because the term expert means you know everything about that specific event or specific type of job. All right, you'll never hear me tell you that I'm an expert in anything, because I'm constantly learning. All right, I'm gonna learn from him down the road. I'm gonna learn from any student that I have. I'm gonna learn from any instructor that I deal with. All right, because the day you stop learning is the day you stop doing anything and just get out of it and find something else to do. So my biggest is self-doubt and making sure that I keep my head in the game where I need to be, so that way I can continue to be the best instructor that I can be and provide the service that I want it to be.
Thank you.
That's the exact same answer that I have. It's self-doubt. It's very hard starting business. It's like, are you ever going to be good enough in your business, or are you going to be able to compete with others? But, you know, to build, to learn, to advance yourself, that's what I try to do every day.
I guess a challenge then is finding clients and going the extra mile to go not just find a client, but chase down and make somebody your client, let them know why they need your services. And really going after them and not letting any potential clients that you would like to serve get away. And so that's been a learning process as I've tried to make this more of a formal venture.
Those are great insights. Thank you. My next question, did someone inspire you to start a business or mentor you through the process?
Well, my mentor is, I don't know if anybody know Miss Donna Jones. She's an Army veteran, and she's used to, I guess, manage the Student Success Center mm-hmm. at the time. That's when I met her. She had great knowledge of a lot of things, not just what she teach or what she's here for. So she managed to give me a lot of good advice and, you know, help me through a lot of things, not just work or school or even personal problems. So that's Donna Jones is the person I go to.
I would probably say my mom and my dad, both of which never went to college, very hardworking people. My dad was a mill technician for years. I think he worked for just about every textile mill around here when they were up and running. And I think he saw back in the early 90s with NAFTA, with things heading out of the country as far as the textile mills, he saw what was happening. And so he really pursued hard after getting his electrical license, and then he just became a full-out electrician. And I just remember helping my dad when I was 7, 8, 9 years old, pulling wire and watching how hard my dad was working out of work. And then by the time I was about 14, he was fully on his own as a full-time electrician. And I just saw that growth of my dad becoming this, you know, guy that went from working for people to working for himself. I saw the challenges of it, but it really built a very tough respect that when you have things to do, you got to get it done, and you don't make money unless you're out there working. And you know, that's just something that really inspired me. I still see that. My dad, he's 60 years old. He's still out there wiring homes, and you know, just a great man of integrity. And he always taught me that, you know, when you promise people something, you do it. If you promise people to do something for a price and you get knee deep and you find out that it's going to be more, well, you still do it, because that's a needed thing. You know, too often today, people are willing to cheat people out of things. And, you know, he just really taught me that in business, there's right and wrong. And you follow those things, you work hard, and the rewards will be there. And I really think just watching him model that in front of me, and my mom worked very hard doing multiple jobs, that just really put that inspiration inside of me as a person. So,
thank you.
I think it was a movie. It's called A Series of Unfortunate Events. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what it's. I didn't really have any type of person or, you know, anything like that. But I had several events that happened over my life that kind of pushed me to do what I do now. And I was told a long time ago when I was in the Marine Corps that my drill instructor told me, he said, if you want to look good, you don't go to a barber, you go to a stylist. So I was actually getting my hair cut, and there were some women in there talking to me, asking me some questions. And, you know, I was rattling off answers, you know, about security and stuff like that. And one girl looks at me, she's like, well, you know all this stuff, why don't you teach it? And I went, there it is. So that's kind of what started everything, started the ball rolling. And I started talking with other instructors around and stuff like that, guys that I trusted. And I'll go and tell you, everybody you can trust, you can count on half your hand. All right, there's gonna be a lot of people out there that you know, that you like, that, you know, you're acquaintance with. You're only gonna count on maybe three that you can actually trust. All right, and so surround yourself and be close with those people, because those are the ones that are gonna help you. All right, and those guys did. I learned from them. I sat down with them and showed them basically my business plan, what I was planning on doing. And there were some things that were like, that's a little sketch. You know, let's see if we can, you know, tweak this a little bit and make it there. And that's how we kind of devised what we did. And I didn't get it right the first time. The first advanced class that I ran, I expected way too much of those guys. Now that class is now five classes. So that way, we adapted the, you know, the crawl, walk, run method of training. And that's kind of where it took off from there.
That's great. Phil, did you have a mentor or someone that helped you through this process?
Yeah, the Small Business Center.
Thank you.
No, I mean, I was kind of scared to go start a business because it seemed out of reach. And it seemed like a really big deal, or like the details were, it just seemed overwhelming, right? So Small Business Center helped me to realize that's really not the case. And they helped me to see all the steps that I needed to do to make this a legit business. And so that, if there's a mentor, you guys did a great job. You should definitely chat with them about that. They've got so many resources and knowledge and a willingness just to help and to serve you to get started. So, nice job.
Thanks, Phil. I did not pay him to say that, but it really is a pleasure to work with clients locally and to see our economy grow and have a part in that. So we would love to be a mentor for those of you. I hope that you have a support system like Josh did, you know, being able to look up to your parents or things like that. We, as Mike mentioned earlier, we don't all have that in our family. You know, if you do have that, hold that dear. Like Sean said, if you have those trusted people that you can be close to, don't take that for granted. But also remember that you do have resources on campus that we would love. You know, we're your support system now, and we want to continue to be that way. Your instructors are here for you now. We have other resources like the Small Business Center that wants to help you as well. So our time is dwindling, and I do want to give you an opportunity to ask questions from the floor. So let me skip down to my last question, or maybe morph the two into one. Maybe if you could tell us one of the most rewarding parts of owning your business, but also if there's a word of advice that you would give to someone here in the audience if they wanted to start their own business. So again, maybe something that's very rewarding about owning your own business, but also a word of advice. And then we'll open it up for questions.
So rewarding for me is just to see businesses or entities with better design and or to see a design on a storefront window. And I know that that's something that I've got that I can offer my community to better my community. And then that's really what this thing's all about. You know, we live here. I live here in Stanley County. I'm a part of this. So while I'm here, I don't want to just be about me. I want to better the lives and the businesses of those around me. So that's been rewarding, and I would challenge you to take what you can do, your skill set, or what you would like to be your skill set, and then to go put that to work for others and in your community. So,
thank you.
Rewarding for me has to be, you know, I help people that manage their pain and discomfort and help them feel better after the session, and be able to work at my own hours where I can have time to, you know, take care of my children if needed. And, you know, my advice is don't be afraid to start something. You have a great resources here, small business, you know, center. They're there, they with information, they assist you any way they could. And anytime you want to.
That's right.
I think just for me, a rewarding part of my business is, you know, going into a neighborhood, and I know I've got three or four properties that I manage, and when you look at the accounts, you can tell which ones I do. They look nice, they look manicured, and then customers, they pass your name on. I mean, you know, in all the years I've done business, I've never one time advertised. It's all been by word of mouth, and when people are willing to share who you are and the fact that you do good work for a good price, and you kind of become known as that kind of person, and that really is a great testimony. I think if I could just encourage anybody, Teddy Roosevelt one time said, just do what you have, though it may seem little, you'll still go far with it. You know, so even if you have a very small amount in your hand, don't think that's too little to do something great with, because I started my business with nothing and took a little bit of a gamble, and it was a calculated step, but it certainly has paid for itself. So very thankful, and thankful for the opportunity.
That's awesome.
For me, the most rewarding part is giving somebody confidence. When you take somebody that is scared to go out in public or scared to be home by themselves, and you give them that sense of confidence where they walk around with their head high and their chest out, and they feel capable of taking care of themselves, you know, that's a huge part for me. Another one is, you know, I work with father and son and mother, daughter, and father and daughter and mother and son teams, you know, and they all come, and it's them to give them time to spend with each other. And when you can put a family or, you know, any two people together during that time and watch them look at each other with enjoyment, and, you know, they're learning from each other and, you know, having that time, that's a huge rewarding part for me. And I know a lot of people use a lot of great quotes from different people, from Churchill to Hill and everything, but I probably got the oldest quote out there. It's from Acrilicus. He was a gladiator from 650 BC. And his quote was this. It says, you do not rise to the level of your expectations, but fall to the level of your training. All right, so if you don't train it, you're not going to do it. You're not going to be that superhero at the end of the day. If you don't go out and learn it, if you don't continue your learning every single day, you're going to fall behind, and that's what's going to kill you.
Wow, fantastic job. Any questions from the floor? I know we have at least one or two, right? Anybody have a question? Don't be shy.
I think they're all ready to go home and go to bed.
Hey. Any questions? Yes, please.
I want to ask if any of you took ownership in businesses and companies you worked for prior to your own business, and also prior to taking classes and going to school, and also any other comments on that that you could add to that?
I got to shout out a lot, so I only heard about part of that.
Ownership, like in entrepreneur spirit, ownership that you had before your own business. Mm-hmm. What did you do? Kind of think on that, maybe something you recall.
Like I said, I joined the Marine Corps at 18. We got into law enforcement after I got out of there, went overseas and contracted. So for me, we actually had some incidents happen where we saw some families, if they'd had a little bit more knowledge and training, you know, in that area, the things could have turned out a little bit differently for them. So we started looking around, The closest place that anybody could go was out west. And that's $900 to $1,200 for a day course. I don't know that many people in this area or in general that can spend $900 to go for a day course, not including room, board, food, and everything else. Mm-hmm. So we took what we learned and said, look, we can apply this to this area and give people an opportunity to get the same training and knowledge at a professional basis. But on, I mean, I got a family too. I got a wife and two kids. So, I mean, it's I know what today's struggles are like. So we give it to people at a price that they can afford. But as far as taking ownership into a company, we took what we learned from that company or those companies and applied them to everyday reality. But we kind of, the good thing about owning your own business is you can pick and choose what training you want to put out there, you know.
Well, for me, is me coming from the East, be able to, you know, offer the Eastern modalities into my service for our local communities that, you know, sometimes you might have to travel to Charlotte or elsewhere to find the kind of service that I'm offer. So just me being here and, you know, offer something a little bit different that, you know, that's something I take pride in and, you know,
A little bit.
Yeah. Well, I guess I think to answer your question, for me, in the jobs that I've had helped to develop skills that I took out and started business. So there was definitely some crossover there. So what I learned or what I needed to go learn to implement to accomplish a task here at the college and in other jobs, they helped me to gain new skill sets to go off on my own as well. So So look for those opportunities if you're in a job now.
Yeah. And I think you answered that the best. Looking at it, seems you took pride in the work you were doing to learn those skills and experiences, which I think is lacking today quite a bit, mm-hmm. which is very important in your own business. Very important in your business. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yes, I agree. Thank you for the question and the insight.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. So I think that we probably have some more questions in the room, but you're a little nervous to ask them in front of everyone. We're building self-confidence. We're getting there through events like this. But I do want to give you the opportunity to maybe ask some questions of our panelists one-on-one basis, get their business card, ask them a little more about themselves. So I'm going to let our panelists go ahead and go to the back so that if you do have a question for them, try and maybe see them out front. Lastly, we do have a goodie bag for you, okay? So on your way out, but to get the goodie bag, you have to sign in. So if you have not signed in yet, make sure that you see Katrina at the table, sign in. And again, it's been a pleasure to have you here today. All right.